สวัสดีค่ะ Now we come to the second part of the chapter 5 We are going to learn about spontaneous process So if you remember from the previous video chapter 5 it is about chemical thermodynamics We talk about or we learn about thermochemistry the first part already We learn about the system and surrounding the direction of change. We look at the system perspective. If the energy is lost from the system, the sign of the energy would be in a negative sign. If energy comes into the system, the sign of the energy will be positive sign. And that sign applies to heat. That transfer between system and surrounding as well. If the system loses heat, the Q would be a negative sign. If the system absorbs heat, the Q would be in a positive sign. And that specific heat at a heat of reaction at a constant pressure has a special name called enthalpy change. Endothermic reaction has a positive delta H. Exothermic reaction has a negative delta H. And hopefully you can do all the calculation about the relationship of stoichiometry and heat of reaction. And also you understand the calorimetry concept and also understand the heat of reaction that calculated from the heat of formation or delta HF. Okay, now let's move on to the second part of chapter 5. We will learn about spontaneity of chemical reaction. That we need two variables. We learn about enthalpy change delta H from previous video. Now, only delta H cannot answer anything about spontaneity of chemical reaction. We will need another variable, very important variable, and that is entropy change or delta S. With these two, we'll be able to answer the question about spontaneity of the reaction. And it would be better just to use one variable to answer the previous question and combine these two together will give us another variable that is called free energy or delta G. And with this delta G, you'll be able to answer, is the reaction of interest spontaneous or not? The objective of this session is for you to understand the concept of spontaneous and non-spontaneous process. And you should know the meaning of entropy and also the free energy. And you have to be able to decide whether a reaction of interest is a spontaneous process or not spontaneous process from the sign of delta G. So let's start by looking at the meaning of spontaneous process. A spontaneous process is a physical or chemical change that occurs by itself. When saying that something occurs by itself, it means when the condition is right, that process can happen without extra push or extra energy or extra work to keep it running. For example, a waterfall will always run downhill spontaneously. We will never see a waterfall go up the hill by itself without the need of the pump or extra electricity to run the pump. A sugar will spontaneously dissolve in a cup of coffee, and water will freeze spontaneously below 0 degrees Celsius, and ice will melt spontaneously above 0 degrees Celsius. And another of spontaneous process, example of spontaneous process, heat will flow from hotter object to a colder object. And iron exposed to water and oxygen will form some rust. And you will see from this, you see from these examples that spontaneous process has preferred direction. One of the main objectives in studying thermodynamics is to be able to predict whether or not a reaction of interest will occur when the reactants are brought together under a special set of conditions. Otherwise, we will waste our time and materials and things without gaining any products. It is very important also when we want to synthesize compound in industry, and it is also very important to understand the biological process. Now see some picture as example of spontaneous and non-spontaneous process. A brand new car spontaneously changed into a very old car. The opposite direction is a non-spontaneous. Without extra work, we will never get a very old looking car to be like new one. This ball will roll downhill spontaneously. It will never roll uphill. Going uphill, this ball would require some work, some extra push. And this also a very obvious example. Skiing downhill, you don't need to do any push. Where going up, ski up the hill, you will need to keep pushing to be able to go up continuously. How about these two pictures? Which one is a spontaneous process? What do you think? Well, I think that everyone would agree that this picture on the left is a spontaneous process. If your mom didn't tell you to clean up your room, you wouldn't do it, would you? Tidying up your room needs some extra work. And if nobody tells you to go to school or study, you would very much like to sleep all day. So this occurs spontaneously. Where on the right side here, getting up, tidying up your room needs some extra work. This wouldn't occur spontaneously for most people. And get up to do the, especially as of now, you do the studying online. You study chemistry. This, for some, wouldn't be a spontaneous process. Well, when the condition is right, I hope that this picture would become your spontaneous process. Naka? Now let's see about delta H or enthalpy change and spontaneity of the process. Recall about delta H a little bit. It tells us about the amount of heat released or absorbed by a reaction or a system during constant pressure. And exothermic process, endothermic process, both can occur spontaneously. So you see that when you have methane in a condition with oxygen, it will burn and give us carbon dioxide and water. When we have proton and hydroxide, it will combine to give us water, and this will release heat and exothermic reaction. Endothermic reaction can occur spontaneously also, like when we have a solid water change into a liquid water. And when we have ammonium nitrate dissolved in water, it will give us ammonium ion and nitrate ion. These two reactions are endothermic process. You see that the other edge cannot tell us about the preferred direction of the change. Both exothermic and endothermic reactions can occur spontaneously. So we cannot predict the reaction spontaneity based on enthalpy change or delta H alone. To make such a prediction, we need to look at both enthalpy and entropy change. So enthalpy change, we learn about that already. And we get delta H value by calorimetry, by Hess's law, and by delta HF. On this video, we will learn about delta S. Delta S or S or entropy is defined as a measurement of the randomness. And this very important variable gives control to the change in this universe. It is found that a natural movement of things, everything in the universe, will move from order to disorder, or from lower entropy to higher entropy. Entropy, definition of it, an easy definition, is a measurement of randomness. This randomness can be regarded as the disorder of the system. The term order and disorder mean the number of way of arrangement. If you have arrangement in a specific sequence, you have some order. If you have arrangement without any sequence, the pattern or arrangement would be disorder. Compare between order and disorder. Since disorder has so many ways of arrangement, it will be high entropy. Entropy of a disordered system is higher than entropy of ordered system. And this particular thing that happening is very important. There is a natural tendency for systems to become disorder. If you would like to go back to the previous slide, it's very natural for all of us to be lazy. It's very natural for all of us to be very untidy, because tidying up our room needs a lot of work, needs a lot of energy to do. So it is natural movement of things to become disorder. Put into pictures for you. Compare these two pictures of a crowd of people. On the left side here, people just gather around together without any pattern, without any sequence. So this would be very high disorder. This picture would have very high entropy. Compared to the right one, people just line up. So we see some pattern, some sequence. So this picture has some order in it. So compare left and right. This one will be low in the entropy compared to the left side. And also on this Lego pieces on the right side here has no pattern. You just have it mixed up on the table without any sequence, and put Lego pieces into shape like this require a lot of work to do, and it's become more order, less disorder. So this left side again has lower entropy than the right side. Now, put things into number. We can calculate the amount of entropy for each substance thanks to Boltzmann. He is a very genius man, and he gave the relationship or mathematics equation for the entropy of things is equal to a constant natural log W. The W is the number of different ways or microstates in which the energy of molecules in a system can be arranged on energy levels. Think of it in a very easy way, like this. W is a number of arrangement. If you can arrange one system in many, many ways, so W will be increased, which means your S or entropy will be increased as well. If you can arrange the system in only one way, for example, in only one way, natural log 1 would be 0, so your entropy would be 0. On this table, show you the number of entropy of different substances, and you will see more from the appendix. From this equation, and I said if you only have W as 1, your entropy would be 0. From the Boltzmann equation, entropy depends on W. W is the number of ways of arrangement of the system. Bring us to this special case, third law of thermodynamics. It is stated that the entropy of a pure crystalline substance or a perfect order at absolute zero temperature is zero. So this is a very special case where you have entropy equal to zero, which means W is 1, as I said earlier. And it's only occur for a very, very, very special case, like in this slide said, for a perfect crystal. Perfect means you can have only one arrangement to be perfect. And also, this crystal has to be at absolute zero temperature, which means no heat. So therefore, no movement of atoms in that crystal. So the entropy would be zero. And until now, we have not reached the absolute zero temperature. So as of now, we don't get entropy of anything as zero. So we can compare the entropy relatively between two substances or more. On this slide, if you want to say one has higher or lower entropy than another, you can compare it in terms of the temperature, or in terms of the state of matter, or in terms of the molecular weight. Relatively, a system at higher temperature will have higher entropy. I said here, for a given system, entropy increases as the temperature rises. Of course, when the temperature increases, the molecules will move faster. So things that move faster will be more disorder, which means more entropy as well. And also the entropy depends on the state of matter. Entropy increases as the substance changes from a solid to liquid to gas. So you have to compare state of matter for the same substance. And this, I have example for you in this table, like this barium in gaseous state has higher entropy than barium in a solid state. Also for bromine. Bromine in gaseous state has higher entropy than bromine in liquid state. And entropy of solution would be greater than pure solid or pure liquid. This is of course very obvious because solution means you have to mix at least two things together. When you mix two things together, it's gonna increase the disorder. Elements or molecules with higher molar mass will have higher entropy because elements with higher molar mass mean it has more proton, more electron, more neutron inside, more particles, more disorder. And you can see from this table example here, calcium chloride has higher entropy than calcium fluoride. Higher entropy than calcium hydride, right? Higher molecular weight. And also entropy increases for compounds which are more complex. So you see calcium nitrate here has more type of atoms. You have calcium, you have nitrogen, you have oxygen. So you get higher entropy, okay? Since we have to look at enthalpy change and entropy change to be able to predict the reaction spontaneity. Now that you know what is enthalpy change, what is entropy change, the question is how do we predict the reaction spontaneity? So we move on to this topic. Second law of thermodynamics, or the criteria for a spontaneous process. Second law of thermodynamics said that all processes occur spontaneously in a direction that increases the total entropy of the universe. Here come again, we talk about entropy of the universe. Our universe consists of system and surrounding. Therefore, change this statement into a mathematical statement. For a spontaneous process, delta S of universe must be increased, which means it's gonna have to be in a positive sign. The change must be more than zero, which means delta S of system plus delta S of surrounding has to be more than zero. This is a criteria for spontaneous process, a very important law that control our changes in the universe. And I put it here together with this spontaneous process criteria for a process at equilibrium. At equilibrium means you don't see any more change. So change of entropy will become zero. But let's focus for the spontaneous process. See, the change of entropy of universe must be more than zero. So you have to look at change of entropy of system together with change of entropy of surroundings. We have to know both values. So as I said, we're gonna focus on a spontaneous process. which means we need to look at both delta S of system and delta S of surrounding. Let me remind you again that for this chapter, the system is something that we are interested in, which means our chemical reaction. So you may see me use this delta S of system and delta S of reaction. These two have the same meaning. So to answer the question, is the reaction spontaneous? We will need to look at what is the value of delta S of reaction and what is the value of delta S of surrounding. For the delta S of system or delta S of reaction, we will use this formula. Do you see? We have seen this pattern before from the calculation of delta H or enthalpy change. Delta S of reaction is equal to the summation of entropy of the product multiplied to the stoichiometric coefficient minus the summation of entropy of reactants, again multiplied by the stoichiometry coefficient. So we use the same pattern or formula to calculate entropy change of system or entropy change of reaction. And the value of entropy of each substances can be seen from the appendix again. So let's see some example here. The question asks you to calculate delta S of reaction for this particular reaction here. First of all, you need to get the entropy of each substance from the appendix, of course. This one in particular, you have to check the unit S or entropy in the tables. In the table, in every general chemistry textbook, it's gonna show you in joule per mole Kelvin unit. List all the entropy of every substances. For the entropy, you don't get the zero for the most stable state of each element. So for oxygen, entropy is not zero, nakha. Make a note here for yourself. Let me remind you again, we put the product first minus the reactant, nakha. So this is your calculation. Put this entropy multiplied by stoichiometry coefficient and this multiplied by number of mole here together, add them summation and then minus for the reactant side and you will get your answer in joule per Kelvin, because mole will be cancelled with mole here. Okay, and this also give you about the sense of correct for your answer. In this particular one, you get delta S of reaction in a negative number, which means your product will have lower entropy than your reactant. Let's check here. Your reactant is gas, where your product gas and liquid. Remember, the entropy of gaseous state is higher than the entropy of liquid state and solid state, right? Your reactant, you have 6 mole of gas. Compared to your product, you only have 3 moles of gas. So number of mole decrease, which means from reactant to product, you have less entropy, which means the entropy change will be in the negative sign. Okay? One way to check if you get the correct answer. When you know delta S of reaction or delta S of system, we still cannot say that the reaction is spontaneous or not spontaneous. We have to look at delta S of surrounding. Okay, delta S of surrounding. How do we get the change in entropy of the surrounding? Remember first law of thermodynamics. Something change in the system must also occur accompanied with the change of surrounding, right? So entropy change of surroundings will be related to the heat change of the system. Say again, the entropy change of surrounding is related to the heat change of the system. So we will see these two diagrams here. On the left side first, this is your system. Your system transfer heat to the surrounding. Your system transfer heat to the surrounding. So what happened to the entropy of surrounding? Entropy increase as temperature increase, right? So when the surrounding gets more heat, the temperature will be increased, which means its entropy increase as well. On the right side here, your system absorb heat from surrounding. When your surrounding transfer heat to your system, the temperature will be decreased, so its entropy decrease as well. From these two pictures, we make a conclusion like this. Delta S of surrounding is related to negative side of heat of the system. You see on the left side, system loses heat, Q of the system will be negative in itself. So delta S of surrounding would be negative of negative value is gonna be a positive sign, means entropy of surrounding increase. On this side, system absorb heat, Q of system is positive. Therefore, delta S of surrounding is negative, which means entropy of surrounding decrease. Not only that delta S of surrounding relate to heat of the system, it is also related to the temperature. The temperature at which the heat is added or removed from surrounding also affect delta S of surrounding. And it said that the change in entropy of surrounding would be greater when heat is added at a lower temperature. So together, this equation and the equation on the previous slide, we get this relationship. Delta S of surrounding is equal to negative sign heat of system divided by temperature. Okay, and a special heat of system or heat of reaction at constant pressure is enthalpy change of system. So we will get this relationship. Change of entropy of surrounding equal to enthalpy change of system divided by temperature.
and the sign would be in the opposite sign. Remember again, temperature must be in Kelvin unit only. Now that we have the way to get delta S of system and delta S of surrounding, delta S of system is calculated from this formula. Delta S of surrounding calculate from this formula. Put these two together, you get delta S of universe as delta S of system minus delta H of system divided by T. So we can predict the spontaneity if we know enthalpy and entropy of system. No more surroundings. Okay. No more surrounding. We put everything relative to the system. Delta S of universe equal to delta S of system minus delta H of system divided by temperature. Okay, let's see some example. The question asks you to calculate delta S of system or delta S of reaction, remember, and delta S of surrounding of this particular reaction. The question also asks you, is this a spontaneous reaction at 25 degrees Celsius? So, you know enthalpy change. Okay, you know enthalpy change, you know temperature, you can calculate delta S surrounding. How about delta S of system? Delta S of system, you do exactly like the way you did in the previous example. So first of all, you get delta S of reaction or system like this, you get the formula and you get all the value from each substances, and here is your delta S of reaction. You may need to pause the video and check the number from the appendix and try to do the calculation by yourself, นะคะ. And for the surrounding, as I said earlier, you get enthalpy change already. You know the temperature, so this one is quite straightforward. Put delta H, put temperature, remember change Celsius into Kelvin, and you will get delta S of surrounding. Now you get this answer, and you get this answer. The question remains, is this a spontaneous reaction? How would you answer this question? You need to find delta S of universe. If delta S of universe is positive, this question would be answered as yes, the reaction is spontaneous. So let's find out. Delta S of universe is delta S of system plus delta S of surrounding. So, delta S of system is this number. Check the unit, นะคะ, joule per Kelvin. Delta S of surrounding is this number in joule per Kelvin. This one is in kilojoule, นะคะ. I already changed unit to get this particular number. นะจ๊ะ. As I said to you, you may pause the video and do your own calculation. And here again, you got a positive number 111. So the delta S of universe is positive, which means the reaction is spontaneous at 25 degrees Celsius. So here we come to the end of this video. Let's see some summary, นะคะ, what we have learned in this video. We learn about the spontaneous process, the criteria to predict a spontaneous process. A spontaneous process is a physical or chemical change that occurs by itself at the right condition. And a spontaneous process has preferred direction. So if one direction is a spontaneous, the opposite direction would be non-spontaneous. And in order to predict the spontaneity of the process, we need both enthalpy change and entropy change. We learn about the entropy, that is the measurement of disorder. The system that has high disorder has high entropy, and check the relative value of each system. And we learn about second law of thermodynamics, which states that a spontaneous process will have a direction that increase entropy of the universe. The entropy change of universe is the combination of entropy change of system plus entropy change of surrounding. And the entropy change of surrounding relates to the enthalpy change of the system in the opposite direction. Okay, please practice, nakha. And again, if you don't get the lecture in any part, you repeat it and pause it and redo the calculation. Make sure that you check all the unit, nakha, because unit is very important in this chapter. Practice, nakha. And I see you again next video, ค่ะ. Bye bye, ค่ะ.